now it's your turn, but I do want to acknowledge something that I forgot to say at the beginning, that today's conversation is co-sponsored by the Vancouver City Planning Commission, and we are very grateful to the commission and the commissioners for their support for this event. They will also have much of this information on their website. Now it's your turn. You're the participants. You can ask questions, make observations of our presenters, and what other participants say. We are recording this, and the mics are at the back, so please use your outside voice as you talk, or at least not a whisper today. Who would like to go first? Just raise your hand, and I will call on you in the back to start. I'm going to assign numbers 2, 3. Let's go.
Hi. Thank you so much for giving us your time today to come and talk about this. I really enjoyed the perspective of planning and urban design and how that's kind of integrated into the project from various different perspectives. I'm just wondering about specifically climate change adaptation strategies and how that's come into play with the conversations around being at the waterfront level, thinking about making strategies around sea level rise and so on and so forth.
I can probably comment on that a little bit because we're looking at strategies throughout the city of how to address that, and from a transportation perspective it's generally like looking at seawall heights and the edge of water heights and that. And so in this location, because everything, all the development is actually up at quite a bit higher level, it's primarily the rail tracks that would be down at the lower level in that kind of risk area for seawater, right? So that would be a question, I guess, that like to connect with CP Rail and the others of how they're planning for that, because that's kind of the closest ground plane. All our other stuff is quite a bit higher.
Number two, and then you'll be number four in the back.
Yeah, I generally like what I see with the hub proposal, but an observation is Vancouver seems to be determined to be the last place on earth that has a pedestrian zone, very free of cars. And if you can't make a successful pedestrian zone in the biggest transit hub in Western Canada, I think we're missing a huge opportunity here. This seems to be very road focused. And I see mostly just a loss of pedestrian space without half of the Granville space being taken away, more than half perhaps, by opening up Granville. I'm not opposed to that as long as it's replaced with good, high quality pedestrian space, and I don't see enough of it here.
It's a good comment, and certainly the devil is in the detailed design. So we have those same goals and ambitions to, particularly at street end views, to provide those open spaces, but also at that ground plane. And we don't really know what the hub street would look like. Yes, while it might be providing a transportation purpose in terms of buses and that, but it could also be a very much a pedestrian environment as well. It certainly could be explored as the framework moves forward.
But I just want to add on that, when we look at the hub framework having a sound logic, it's saying certain things need to be connected, and the next question is exactly that. Connected for what means? Some of it is servicing of vehicles, transit vehicles, and so on. But a lot of it is if you're putting all the development and so on there and have the vision that still is part of the back of our mind from some of the stadium things that could have happened at that intensity, that's a pedestrian, that's a people place. So that's how we're looking at it.
Yeah, I guess the concourse piece was something that we kind of envision as being a big pedestrian mixing area, and how that actually works, if it could actually be something that has pedestrian space around the outside that looks into it, the seawall corridors around the outside edges, and then kind of that lookout plaza area by this sea bus terminal, like that would be the point where you're right looking over the water and being able to have the pedestrian space in that area too.
And you're number five. Who's number three, please? Yes.
Yeah. Number four.
I'm sorry, number three?
Me.
Oh, good.
Hi.
Yes, thank you.
Can I ask two questions? One is there any
practical legal mechanism for the 555 Cordova site that the city can totally disallow any development there so that it remains an open plaza?
There is, under the current zoning, they have the ability to develop that piece of land.
They, meaning Cadillac Fairview?
Cadillac Fairview, yes. Now, it's subject to all kinds of performance, as Frank mentioned, and it's subject to, you know, its urban design performance, its architecture, its public realm, all that. I mean, even in the hub plan, we had envisioned, you know, we had envisioned a smaller building, it is a framework. So they've been testing with us something other than that, and as of yet, they have not been successful, so.
Right, okay, so possibly, could remain open. The architect from Cura. On your sketch, there was the chartreuse green in the hub area, air rights or whatever over the tracks. Then there were two fingers leading down towards Craft Park in a magenta color. Is that open for development? Moving further east, or what is that magenta?
I'm losing track of precisely which slide, but.
It was one of your last slides. These were slides of the chartreuse around the hub area and magenta.
Yeah, so, oh, that's right. So the magenta in that slide, that is the entirety of the rail yards that our client owns.
Right.
Bought it as one job.
So can that area be built over by the city reps here as part of our waterfront?
In theory, it can.
Uh-huh.
And it's just a question of where the process goes. Some of those previous studies and plans had talked about, well, if the rail yard goes, you can maybe do da-da-da-da-da, but if the rail yard stays, you've got some height there. It seems very unlikely in terms of general probability that one would want to take on the expense of doing that. And so the focus has been at the western end around the hub.
But you're from the city planning. What's the conversation from the city on this, on that more? East of the hub, what's happening there?
East of the hub. Well, there's a couple things you have to think about. It does depend if the rail lines stay or not. So if the rail lines stay, now you're talking about an elevated structure that has to be of a certain clearance height. And you have to think about that relationship with the backside of Gastown.
Exactly.
So that causes some anxiety from an urban design perspective that I would say that we would be, you know, somewhat uncomfortable, because now you've lost the backside of Gastown.
The whole historic face of Gastown.
So do we see some future development there? Perhaps if the rail lines were gone, but in the interim, from my perspective, an elevated structure that blocks the north side of Gastown, I don't think there's something.
And the only thing that is on the table is that the rail yards are there to stay.
Yeah, that's right.
So this is not an either or debate amongst any of us.
And I guess just to add to that, like during the hub study, we looked at whether, like initially there was the stadium proposal that was right behind the landing there.
Yeah.
And so for a stadium being in that location, and you know, 15,000, 18,000 seat stadium to access out through the landing and the lane was very challenging. And a lot of it is that grade level. So if you think of, as you go to Gastown, Water Street actually falls down more
down
towards the track level versus where you're up at Cordova and the station building, it's all at a higher level, right? So you're already starting at a lower level, then having to create building development and then putting it over rail tracks. So it's complicated enough as it is on the eastern end where everything kind of starts spreading out with the rail tracks, but you bring that down to kind of the tail end of the tracks, and it's just quite challenging to go over there.
Right. It just strikes me as if we look at the hub, mm-hmm. looking east of that hub area over the tracks, I haven't heard it in the conversation.
Okay. There was one component of a connection over the tracks to get to Craft Park, where we have another street right away there at Canby, I think it is Carroll. Yeah.
Number four, the gentleman in the back.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I just want to say really appreciate hearing the different perspectives from the city staff, but also having Frank and Graham provide some of that historical context for the waterfront and some of the urban design considerations from two experienced private sector perspectives is a nice combination, so I really appreciated that. The question I have is, with so many different property owners, some of them private, some of them different levels of government or rail, I'm wondering how this project is being financed and if any of them are involved in the financing of this, and also in regards to 555 Cordova, if it appears there's going to be a natural propensity for any developments there to go above the existing height guidelines because of the value capture potential to finance some of these things too.
So the issue of finance was something that we certainly struggled with back in 2009 when this went forward, because given all the various property owners, and like I said, the city doesn't own any of this property, we do have some rights for roads, we always identified that it required multi-level government support. The port being, you know, an extension of the feds, TransLink being an extension of the province. In order for this framework, this vision to happen and to build such a facility, it can't be beholden entirely on the backs of the property owners, Cadillac Fairview or Carrera Kerfoot. It's a multi-partnership to deliver this, and we understood that at the time, and that still remains to this day.
What sense of commitment are you getting so far from those other levels of government? Have they been at the table at all in the process here yet at this stage?
Certainly TransLink was involved with us it in terms of developing the plan. It really requires more political will per se than at a staff level to champion the development, the vision, and we all know how challenging that can be from, you know, look at our province right now with the transit referendum, right? We haven't got that, you know, leadership from the province to deliver that. So, you know, this is another major opportunity, and we have to elevate it. I mean, I'm thrilled about the discussion that's going on, you know, that it's been, you know, it's been generated around the recent development proposal, but it's making people more aware of what this opportunity is, because it has gone kind of silent since 2009 when we're out in the public talking about it, and it needs to get elevated again.
That's why we're having this conversation. Number five, what, please.
He had a second part to his question about the height of 555 Abbott Street, excuse me, West Cordova, going above, I live at 555 Abbott, that's why I said that. Going above the guideline height, which I presume you mean the hub plan of 11 stories, there's probably in all likelihood a chance that it'll go higher than that. The question is how high, and what materials, what color, what relationship on the site, what are the benefits for public realm and access. So it's conditional on a lot of things, including, as we said, the performance of it as a urban design framework.
And one of the key things as we're doing our development plan, in the process of preparing a plan to submit to the city, is to understand, as we skip forward, and as you see from the history, certain things stay the same, certain things change. As we skip forward about eight, nine years to what it will take for our development site to be feasible, vis-a-vis our neighbor on Cadillac and the exact location of the viaducts, which none of us pointed out. There is a right of way, and almost none of us showed stuff that was on the legal right of way. So we have to go back to that kind of thing, look at the existing viaduct right of way and see why there would be any reason to move it forward, and it then impacts everybody in the circle that we've been talking about.
One comment just on like what would actually spur this to happen. Like when we were doing the hub plan, it was right around the time when the convention center was actually being constructed. And if you look to the west, all that road network was actually developed as part of that plan, and then the other developments came in with that. And similar with Canada Place, you know, you get a lot of those big viaduct structures get developed with the convention center or some big push on that. And we kind of flagged that during the hub study that it may need that kind of push of a further expansion of the convention center or something like that, because it's really expensive infrastructure just to be able to access and service all that area.
Okay, one moment. It's about 1:30. We normally stop at 1:30. We did say that we are extending this conversation because of the interest in it, and thank you for all for coming to it. You're showing the interest in this issue. We are extending this to 2:00. Number five we have picked, number six is here, number seven, and there was a number eight, somebody who had their hand raised here, number eight. So number five, please, Grace Baxter.
Thank you. I was so shocked when I saw the picture of the proposed building and the way it didn't relate to anything at all. In fact, this led me to say the Martians had landed. And yet I was also concerned that why did I suddenly come across this? I had seen the HUD plan, the old HUD plan was a great plan. It was moving in the right direction. And then to suddenly find that there, after what I believe would be months or weeks, at least, of discussion with the city, without any commentary at all about anybody being concerned. I remember an older director of planning would have refused it on site and made a fuss about it because it was so out of gear with the plans that were happening. Now, how did that then get to that place? Why are we now here discussing this without a sort of understanding? Because if you read the application and the words in the application, you'll find very complimentary language about how compatible it is with everything, how it protects the various view lines. And yet something went wrong in the process, and as much as we now sort of lately dealing with and finding these nice comments from the people here, and yet why is it that it gets to this stage without all these concerns being worked out before it goes into the confusion of public discussion?
Comment 5A.
Thank you.
It's a question.
It's a question.
Responses?
Yeah.
I second the emotion.
Well, so we have a, anyone can make a development application, and we have to take it through a process. I'll answer it like that.
Okay, number six. Yes.
So the question then is, what is required for the HUD study and all of the current proposals and the implications of them to be looked at as a single comprehensive process?
What is required? I'm not sure I understand the question. So, I mean, any development, we're going to look, any development proposal within the HUB framework, we're going to reference back to the HUB framework and look to see how it continues to deliver and achieve the objectives that we have set out in the plan.
So let me put it another way. Would it make sense, as council has done in the past, is to set up a separate planning process and community consultation to look at all these projects in the context of HUB to see whether it needs to be renewed and what the other opportunities may be to follow from? Given that there is so many projects at a scale unanticipated when the HUD's project is done.
If I can jump in here, the citizens group at which I'm a part would certainly think so. If this is the first toe in the door, and it's so out of keeping, as Ray just mentioned, with what we thought we had a good framework for, it does beg the question, should the whole HUB area be opened up to a more fulsome process?
No, it doesn't beg the question. I don't want it to be. What do you need to do to get that?
I don't want it to be. I'd rather the HUB plan be a stronger document that our council, and well, actually council's not even involved in this, that staff can rely on and use a stronger tool to say no or yes. Or
you guys are awfully hard to lead.
What do you need to do to have a process? You need somebody to say, we're going to have a process.
Should council, someone on council and council vote on a planning process for the HUB and all of the projects as a separate process?
I'd say that there's two different ways that one can go. The city can convene a process, and I know that has to go through a whole deliberation budget cycle and so on. But the fact of the matter is that we are now engaged in preparing a development application that we're assuming is working within the HUB framework. So that's the other mechanism that will make something happen. I don't want to damn the other process because the guys with some development rights put in an application, you know, as one can do. They're called to not engage the community, including the adjacent landowners, but we're going into a process to establish what we can and can't do, must and must not do, because the big decision in there now is the time to move forward with such a plan. We have seen the take-up of all the office buildings and so on. Let's kind of assume that they generally take up with new people coming in. There's a lot of energy that you can either capture into the downtown. And so we're going to see, what does it take to make this place work? So that will become itself a public process. So there's two different routes, and our client has proactively decided we had better get in there and see, first of all, technically and physically what we can do and some of all of that background due diligence you have to do, and then enter in. We've started the process with the city.
Are you meeting with the other developers to find out what you might be able to do?
Absolutely. Those conversations are happening. They'll go whichever route they go business-wise.
Does it make sense then to do it with the city?
No. You know, I mean, yes, in the second step, but you're talking about the first step of the dance, I think is for the parties with the lands to sort out where are the areas of interest and opportunity, working closely and liaising with the city to get to a proposition.
Liaising closely with the city implies that you would have a process and some community participation with it.
Totally. Yeah.
To answer some of these questions, so why not set that up?
Not for us to set it up.
Talk to council, is
it? Yeah, that part of it.
You would need direction and presumably resources.
We're trying to help the city by proactively stepping forward.
They're trying to help us deliver the plan. As
yes.
a property owner, they're trying to help us deliver the plan.
Would it be helpful to the city to have a funded process, in part by contributions from the developer, to take a comprehensive look at all projects, city interests, private interests, community interests, to be discussed as a separate process?
I'm not sure where. Okay, what I'm trying to understand from your question is, happy to have a public process around which we would do anyways through a development permit process.
Single project.
Yeah, but it could be looked at in combination depending on the timing of different things. So what I'm not understanding is. Are we revisiting the plan by doing that? So then you think the plan, the basic structure, the basic approach of the plan is flawed then?
You don't have an implementation strategy, do you?
No, we don't. As
so
I said in the very beginning.
That component, along with all the parties who you know now have specific projects,
yeah.
plus the additional things that have been raised, why not have a separate process to look at that? Bring it all together. Council then would have something before it, maybe consultation,
yep.
and then moves forward. The parties all know where they stand.
I guess I'm saying that we did that when we
and implementations provided.
We did do that when we developed the plan. There was community consultation when we developed the plan.
But no implementation.
The only implementation was that we identified that we had a lot of challenges because it involved a number of different parties and government.
So that's it in a nutshell.
Yeah.
You work out the challenges.
Number 7 with this gentleman, and number 8 is over here, and then number 9 is
I have an observation, and then I've got a question. My observation is, as a former member of the Vancouver Heritage Commission, I was shocked and appalled, that the commission went along with and approving that design in the middle of that space, that Martian landing, which was back in the snow. That's number one. My question really is, and I guess it's the elephant in the room here, what's the status of that project? Is it going ahead as designed, or is it not?
We don't have Cadillac Fairview here to respond to that.
I can answer some of that. So following their non-support from the urban design panel, the applicant team has been rethinking their approach. City staff have not been apprised of what that approach is. That's the status. So basically the project is on hold until they choose to engage with us again in response to the panel's comments.
I'd personally like to see some leadership, and I'm not seeing that, I'm not hearing it. It's what Mr. Price has just been talking about. I think that in an overall context, this hub idea is great, but I suspect there's just too many little parts that are not being put together. And I think that's what Mr. Price is talking about here. And this is what really appalls me about this design.
If I could add something.